Welcome to Doggo.jl, your home for wholesome Julia tutorials. In the last chapter on named tuples, we used a name to identify the value of an element. In the coding world, this is an example of a key-value pair, where a quote-unquote key is used rather than an index number to access the value of your data. Depending on the nature of your data, it may be easier to retrieve your data by using a name rather than a number. While the named tuple is a great data structure for small datasets, it becomes less efficient for large datasets. As your datasets grow larger, you may want to use a different type of data structure that can store and retrieve data using a key-value pair, whose performance is independent of the size of your data. For those cases, you may want to consider using a hash table. Depending on the programming language, this data structure is referred to by different names. The Julia implementation of the hash table data structure is called a dictionary. Let's take a look at an example. I'm in VS Code and I've already created a new .jl file. I've also launched the Julia REPL by using Alt-J, then Alt-O. And I've adjusted my user interface so that my REPL window takes up roughly half of my screen. To construct a dictionary, use the DICT constructor. For key-value pairs, the key goes on the left-hand side, and the value goes on the right-hand side. In between is the pairs operator, which maps the key to the value. The pairs operator is spelled P-A-I-R-S, and it's the equal sign character immediately followed by the greater than sign character. Now, I'm not suggesting that you follow my example, but just for demonstration purposes, I wanted to show that the key can be any data type, and the value can also be any data type. As a side note, the data type with a colon immediately before it is an example of a Julia data type called a symbol. I haven't covered this data type before because this data type is not common in other programming languages. In Julia, a symbol is a data type that looks like a string, but somehow, magically, doesn't take up any memory.
Wow!
Because of its unique characteristic, you'll see the symbol data type used in Julia in situations where a string may be used in other languages. For example, in Julia, a symbol data type is often used as a key. Whether you realized it or not, the names in the named tuple are symbols and not strings. The usage of the Julia symbol is more advanced, so it's beyond the scope of this beginner series. But I wanted to include the symbol in this example so you can at least see it in action. In the REPL, you'll see the dictionary displayed with three entries. Note that the data type is DICT, with the keys of type any, and the values also of type any. A dictionary is an unordered collection, so it may be displayed in a different order than the order in your code. Because it's unordered, you can't sort a dictionary. To access the values stored in your dictionary, use square brackets immediately following the variable name of your dictionary. In between the square brackets, enter the key. You can combine this syntax with the assignment operator to mutate the value associated with that key. Note that the new value does not need to be the same data type as the original value. To see the mutated dictionary, use the variable name for your dictionary. You'll see the updated dictionary in the REPL. To add a new key-value pair entry, use the same syntax, but use a new key in between the square brackets. In the REPL, you'll see that your dictionary now has 4 entries. Also note that the new entry is displayed in a random position, since the dictionary is an unordered collection. To remove a key-value pair entry, use the popBank function. The first argument is the variable name for your dictionary, and the second argument is the key that you want to remove. In the REPL, you'll see that your dictionary now has 3 entries. Interesting, right? Now that you've seen tuples, arrays, and dictionaries, here's how to think about these data structures. Tuples are extremely efficient at storing and retrieving your data, but they are the least flexible, so you should only consider using them for small data sets. Arrays provide a nice balance between efficiency and flexibility, so they can be used for many different applications. But as your data set grows larger, it may take longer to access your data. Dictionaries offer a solution for large data sets, since due to the nature of hash tables, the amount of time it takes to retrieve data is independent of data size. But dictionaries require more memory upfront than either a tuple or an array, so it's not ideal for small data sets. So that's the basics of using a dictionary in Julia. In the next chapter, you'll learn what a struct is and how to use it in Julia.